Well, good morning. It is great to be here with you. We'll take this for January 29th, won't we? This kind of weather. This is all right. How many would pass the marshmallow test? Like five or six of you? For another marshmallow, we might have to buy several bags of marshmallows for this crowd. You know, what kid would not dive into one of those marshmallows? And what kid would not walk by a river with all the stones laying around? And what would that kid do? Pick up a stone and do what? Throw it in the water. There are two disciplines when it comes to stone skipping, because it would be like... You know, let's see how many we can skip. There's two disciplines in the world on that kind of thing. One in Europe and one in America. In Europe, they measure the distance that a stone will go. In America, they measure the number of skips. And in Europe, the world champion, Dougie Isaacs, he's from Scotland, he has the world's record for distance, and they call it over there stone skimming. You want to see a practice run of his? Let's check it out. Now watch it in slow motion. Watch this. Oh, my. And then there's slow motion applause. And in America, the world champion stone skipping is Matt Steiner. Matt threw, how many do you think? Just give me a, how many skips? 18. If I can make seven, I'm like, yeah. 88. 88. He was filmed doing it, actually doing it, in 2013. Watch this. The bottom half shows the number, and the top half is the actual skip. We're only in the 60s. There it is. And I don't know who Doug, Jerry, and Max are, but he blew them away. How about that? That's pretty cool, isn't it? It was filmed back then, and interestingly enough, in the closing remarks of this sermon that we are learning from Jesus, he ties it in through the Old Testament in very similar ways to what we just witnessed. Jesus closes his prayer, what we call the Lord's Prayer, with these words. He says, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Matthew 6, 12 and 13. In the line right before he teaches us, his disciples, this line, he says to them, this was from last week, that many of you maybe watched online, right? Okay, because it was snowing and we had like this little small group here. And, but the line right before it, he says, say this to the Father, give us this day our daily bread. Now Jesus steps it up a notch. He teaches them how to ask for daily bread. And then he steps the asking up a notch when he tells them to ask for something else. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. In essence, Jesus was, by adding this into the prayer, Jesus was acknowledging that sin is real. It's not something that you can slough off, that it's not really happening. It is real. It's a very real thing that he's saying to his followers, ask about this. Don't pretend it doesn't exist. He is saying there are things in this life that miss the whole point of life. And they actually even look good at first. They look good, but they are sin. They are missing the mark, and they will burden your life down. And the way to release yourself from sin is not to pretend that it doesn't matter, that you can get over it, that it really is not a big deal. The way to release yourself from sin is to come to God and ask the Father for forgiveness. He was saying, your sins can be forgiven. And I know today that there's some people either listening online, some people who walked in here, and your sins aren't forgiven. And you have that to deal with in your life. In saying this, that your sins can be forgiven, he is referring to several Old Testament passages before him that proclaim the forgiveness of God. The Old Testament gets heavy-duty airtime on the wrath of God. A lot of people want to call, the Old Testament is, a wrathful God. You haven't read the Old Testament. If you have, you would see that there are massive amounts of the forgiveness of a forgiving God in the Old Testament. But the one that I particularly like is from the book of Micah. And it says this: Is there any God like you, forgiving iniquity? Now there's another word, because when we say the Lord's Prayer, we use forgive us our trespasses. Trespasses is another word for sin. Iniquity is another word for sin. Iniquity means this: crooked patterns of behavior. Crooked patterns that get into our life that no one can see, but they are crooked and they aren't on point for what God would have. And we have to deal with those by ourselves. So Micah says, is there any God like you, forgiving iniquity, passing over transgressions by the survivors who are your heritage? He is not angry forever because he delights in gracious love. He's speaking about our God. He will again show us compassion. He will subdue our iniquities. He will hurl all their sins into the deepest sea. In saying that he will hurl, I love that last line in the Micah passage. In saying that he will hurl our sins into the deepest sea, Micah is providing a picture like that of rocks being picked up, just like we just saw, and just being thrown. Like when I ask the Father to forgive my sins, I am literally handing over my sins to Him, and He takes them like a rock and throws them into the deepest part of the sea so that I know, my spirit knows, those are no longer a part of me. To further give illustration to this, I want to show you my satchels. I got them at birth. You got them too. We carry them around everywhere we go, don't we? Today, you're going to get a chance to see my satchels. Here's one of them. What do you think? Look good? Okay. Here's another one. This is a special one to me, too. How's that? But I have a couple more. Here's one that I just really adore. And there's one last one. How do I look? Does this look good? Well, I've shown you mine. You show me yours. But these satchels we get at birth, every one of us gets them. And God wants us to fill these satchels with every great thing in life. And it kind of relates to what He said to Adam and Eve. He said, every fruit, every tree, you're free to pick the fruit from every tree except one. In essence, what He was saying for today's illustration was, fill these satchels with every good thing. But don't pick up the rocks. Don't pick them up. And so in my humanness, my response back to God is, what rocks? What rocks? I don't see any rocks. Do you see any rocks? Anybody? See any rocks? I don't see any rocks. I don't see any rocks. Wow. That is a good rock. What could be wrong with this? Don't pick up the rocks. What are you talking about? Have you seen this rock? I'm just going to hang on to that one. I'll put it right there. No. Okay, I'm not hanging on to the rocks. We're good. Whoa! Where'd all these rocks come from? They weren't here before. I didn't see those. Don't pick up the rocks. Are you kidding me? These are beautiful. Don't pick up the rocks. Watch this. Oh, yeah. Look at these rocks. Oh, my goodness. Oh, here's another one. Oh, that's kind of unique. Don't pick up the rocks. Okay, well, I'll hide it behind that one. Just tuck it in there, right there. Don't pick up the rocks. Are you kidding? These satchels were made for rocks. Right? Let's see, I can get a couple in here. Right there. Oh, I have that side pocket. There's another. Oh, that one will fit right in there. And, oh, yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh. And that's a red one right there. This one won't bother anybody. good. I'm fine. Are you fine? I'm okay. I'm okay. Are you all right? Okay. Just don't mind me. Ooh. Goodness. Don't pick up the rocks. You meant that for somebody else today, right? Don't pick up the rocks. I can't stop picking up the rocks. This one, there's so many of them. You want a rock? No. No fun. No fun. That one I can skip right there. I bet I could get the world's record on that one. Right there. It's getting a little heavy, but I'm okay. I'm all right. Oh, I still got one pouch. Might as well. I've already started loading myself down with some good rocks, and there's so many of them. They're so good looking. Oh, okay, right there. Here, here, and here. Okay, I am a rock picker. What are you going to do? Just leave me alone about it. It's my life. I'm okay. I'm okay. Sort of. Okay. Okay. I should have done this at a younger age. Okay. One more. I got room for one more. I'm fine. Man, I hope this sermon's over quicker. Then he adds to this statement. He doesn't just say, ask for the forgiveness of your sins. He adds to the statement, he says, as we forgive those who sin against us. By saying this, he is calling his followers who are weighed down by rocks, by sin themselves, to understand that they play a part in helping others release their rocks or sins. He is saying he is drawing a biblical connection between being forgiven and forgiving. Being able to forgive others. In fact, after Jesus talked about prayer, of all the statements in the Lord's Prayer that he made, he comes back to, in this model prayer, he comes back to this topic, the forgiveness of sin. In verses 14 and 15, after he says the prayer, this is the prayer to the disciples, he says to them one more time, because if you forgive people their offenses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive people their offenses, your Father will not forgive your offenses. Man, I have struggled with that verse for all my life. So I began to break it down for myself, and I came up with this statement. Listen to this statement. It'll be on the screen. Okay, so Jesus is saying by this, I cannot expect to be forgiven until I start learning and practicing forgiveness toward other people. But I cannot truly forgive other people until I have experienced true forgiveness myself. So what that means is, if I really want to forgive you, any of you, guess what I have to do to truly forgive? Because I can lip service forgiving you. But if I am weighted down, and right now I am weighted down, until I experience true forgiveness myself, I really don't know how to forgive you, is what he's saying. So, the question that plagues all of humanity is, how do I get my life right? If I was told not to pick up the rocks, and I have spent my whole life just picking up rocks, filling my satchels with the things he told me not to, then I look back at this prayer, and I don't pretend like they don't matter, because they do matter. And the longer I go through life, the harder it becomes to carry this. And so the one way to get rid of the rocks around my neck is why he said this: come to me, all you who are weary and loaded down with burdens, and I will give you rest. There's only one way that he's provided, and it's himself. The question becomes, how do I get rid of this? And the answer is, you ask the Father for forgiveness, and he gives you rest, and then you learn how to forgive others. So what I must do is, I must turn to him, and I must kneel before the altar and give these rocks to him. But wait, the prayer is not over. And I'm not going to give these up yet. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Has anybody seen that rock? Lead us not into temptation. My satchels are full, but that is such a pretty rock. I want it. Lead us not into temptation. And what he gives us is, he gives us five ways that he leads us out of temptation. The first way is, we have been studying it for this first month, is prayer. He gives us prayer to lead us out of temptation. When he was in Gethsemane, look at the verse. When he was in Gethsemane, he came back to the disciples and he said, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So prayer is one of the ways that he leads us away from temptation. The second way is that he is through his promises. He promised that he would not leave us, nor would he forsake us. And it says this in his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who's called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. We have the capability, even though our life looks like this, we have the capability of participating in the divine nature because of his promises. The second way that he leads us out of temptation is through the promises that he gives. The third way is through his people. He has given us his people. It is why we come together. Ecclesiastes says this. It says, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. If I have men in my life, if you as a woman have women in your life, that they call on you when there's that moment when you want to just go your own way and God is calling you to go this way and you want to go that way, and you have those best friends, those people that understand and they pull you back. In Ephesians 3:10, he says this, it is why the church, we have the church, because through the church, the manifold wisdom of God is to be made known to the world. It's why we come together. And if you don't use it, you're saying, I can go it alone. I can withstand picking up that rock by myself. And you're playing right in to the evil one's plan. So the third way that he has to pull us back from temptation is his people. The fourth way is himself. In Psalm, it says this. It says, you guide me. Speaking of the Lord, you guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you will take me into glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire beside you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart. Psalm 73. The fourth way is through himself. He will be your guide. And then the fifth way that we are led out of temptation is through his word. His word. When he was tempted in the wilderness for 40 days, the tempter came and Jesus said over and over again, it is written. So the fifth way is through his word. But I don't want to stop there with his word. In 1993, I went to my first Promise Keepers conference. There was 50,000 men in the Boulder, Colorado stadium. And out onto the stage walked Evie Hill and spoke about the power of the word to pull us back from temptation. And he said this.
Jesus did not show the devil his glory because we don't have no glory. I go my vest right here. Nobody won't be blown away. Jesus did not say, devil be done, because I couldn't have said it. Jesus had to do something that everybody in here can do. And I'm fixing to give it to you right now because I want you to use it tonight. I want you to use it tomorrow. I want you to use it tomorrow night. I want you to use it for the rest of your life. Jesus said, devil, it is written. It is written. That's what he said. It's written. In other words, Jesus went to the book of Deuteronomy and came out with scripture. And every time the devil opened his mouth, Jesus threw scripture in his mouth. He came back at him again and he said, devil, it is written. Man shall not live by bread alone. It is written. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. He hit him over and over and over with the scripture. And guess what happened? The devil ran. And guess what you can do beginning tonight? You don't have to take it. You don't have to take his mess. You don't have to take his stuff. Hit him. It is written. When the devil comes up and says, how do you know you've been saved? You are not saved. Yes, I am saved. Hit him. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Hit him, hit him, hit him. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Hit him. There is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. Hit him. How are you going to make it? My God shall supply my every need. How are you going to go through? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. It's written. It's written. It's written. It's in the book. It's in the Bible. All you have to do is take out your Bible and say, where are you, devil? Come on, devil. Let's get it on. Let's get it on. Hit him. Hit him. Hit him. Let's get it on. He's defeated. Our Lord is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hit that devil with the word. Hit him! Hit him! Hit him!
Yeah, that's 50,000 men. Understanding the power of what God has given us to lead us out of temptation. Are you tired of those rocks hanging around your neck? Are you done with it? Are you tired of it? Are you tired of it, and are you ready to give them to him so that he can set the universal world record on skimming or skipping your sins into the deepest parts of the ocean? Or can you take care of them yourself? Are you still taking care of those yourself? Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Only Jesus can do that. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much, Lord, for making this prayer so incredibly clear to us. Thank you for answering the question of the disciples, Lord, teach us how to pray. And you not only taught them how to pray, you showed them the power around the words that you came to the Father with. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your promises. Thank you for your people. Thank you for yourself. And thank you for your word. In Jesus' name, amen.